Hello, I'm Philip North. I'm the Bishop of Burnley in the Diocese of Blackburn. Welcome to Preston Minster, where we're very lucky to hear a lecture given by Dr. Jeremy Worthen, who's the Church of England's Secretary for Ecumenical Relations and Theology. Jeremy will be addressing the question, Renewal and Reform, does it have a theology? He'll be looking at the Renewal and Reform programme across the Church of England and asking whether it's just management light or if it's really rooted in Anglican theology and tradition. Here in the Diocese of Blackburn, we are implementing Renewal and Reform with our own Diocesan strategic vision, Vision 2026. If you want to find out more about the diocese or that vision, then just go to the Diocesan webpage, which is www.blackburn.anglican.org, and you might especially want to look at the vision pages. Before the lecture, we're going to see a short interview with Jeremy with our communications manager, Ronnie Semley.
My name is Jeremy Worthen. I'm the Secretary for Ecumenical Relations and Theology at the Council for Christian Unity for the Church of England, based at a church house in Westminster. I think what I want to say is that renewal and reform comes out of some very serious theological work that's actually been done over many decades, thinking about the church and mission, and about mission and growth, and there's some really substantial thinking behind that. I also think that Renewal and Reform as a programme has some quite creative things to say about how we as a Church of England respond to the situation of secularisation and decline, whatever quite we think those words mean, but that situation that faces all the churches in this country and across Europe indeed. I think Renewal and Reform has got some quite distinctive things to say about how the Church of England needs to respond to that situation. And I actually think the words Renewal and Reform are really important, and they provide a very rich theological framework for thinking about our response as a church to what's happening in our country at this time and how we share the gospel in our country at this time. I think one of the things I want to say is that I think that the theology that's needed in this context isn't something about people like me who sit in an office at Church House producing some long document that no one's going to read, but that somehow gives legitimacy to what we're doing because we've kind of done our homework and it's this great long document. I think the theology that we need in a context like this is an ongoing conversation, an ongoing process of reflection, which needs to engage people up and down the country, involved in seeking to share the good news in the context where they find themselves. And I hope that's part of what I can put across tonight. I'm looking forward very much to the formal question session at the end of the lecture and to just chatting with people over a glass of wine afterwards. It does seem to me that in church life at the national level, as at the local level, there are times of growth, there are times of plateauing, and there are times of decline, and that's how it is. But I don't think there's something inevitable about a pathway of decline. And I think it would be quite wrong and quite limiting in terms of how we see the grace of God and the work of God to think that we're locked into some kind of irreversible cycle here. But there can be a church where there's a really strong dynamic of engagement with the community, of sharing the good news, and you go back to that church 5 years later and somehow the kind of the glory has departed from the place. What is it that brings that spark, and what is it that means the spark kind of dies down and doesn't quite function? I think it is a challenge for all of us to be really committed to sharing what we have. It's a challenge for all of us to keep looking outwards and not end up just getting locked, looking inwards and our own particular issues and problems and all the rest of it. And it's a challenge to keep seeking prayerfully and carefully and thoughtfully to say, what is the Spirit saying to us, and what is God wanting us to do in this place and with these people and in this community? Yeah, and it's not easy, and there's no sort of magic recipe. It's not like you can just crank a handle and it all happens. I think I'd seen I was ordained back in 1994, and I think I've seen in the years that I've been in ordained ministry, in different contexts, in a parish and then in theological education and now at Church House Westminster, in different contexts. But I think I do see a turning of the tide in that there's a general raising of awareness and general acceptance among clergy and among lay people that the church needs to look out. The church needs to be willing to do new things if that's what God is asking us to do for the sake of the good news, for the sake of the kingdom. And that's really exciting.
It's a real pleasure to welcome Jeremy Worthen to the Diocese and to our evening this evening. It's a few months ago, actually, I was in London talking about relationship, I think, to sort of put a challenge to Jeremy to provide some theology, almost a retroactive theology to renew and reform.
as it's a challenge to be really splendid, not by accepting the invitation to come and speak to us tonight. Jeremy is the Secretary for Ecumenical Relations and Theology, so he works at Church House. As I suppose, are you the closest for Church House to Master Steve? Is that your role? Jeremy studied in Cambridge and Toronto. He trained for the priesthood at Ripon College, Cuddesdon, the Old Vatican. And then worked for a parish in Bromley before spending some years training ordinands at site in the South East Institute for Theological Education. He's written a wide range of books, and he's also now canon theologian at Canterbury Cathedral. So it's really good to have him with us. We're going to listen to Jeremy speak to us, then there'll be a chance after that to think about it and then ask him some questions before we finish our evening. It's the summer refreshments. Thank you.
Renewal and reform, does it have a theology? Where is the theology? I first started to notice that question perhaps a decade and a half ago when I was on the staff at the South East Institute for Theological Education, as Bishop Fuller was just explaining, and I was beginning to get drawn into conversations about papers circulated to us from Church House. I know that question, where is the theology, asked more often and with more anger and anguish when I eventually became a principal myself and spent time more regularly with my fellow principals. Where is the theology, we would say to one another, regarding the latest set of proposals. What changed? This being a rhetorical question, because asking it meant we were pretty sure what we couldn't actually see it. And at the time, we thought the question mattered for at least two reasons. One was that you really do need to do some theology if you're going to engage in change in the life of the church. And the other was that we actually knew quite a bit about theology and about my area of work, and we thought we were in a pretty good place to relate one to the other. Well, somehow between then and now, I have made the transition from being one of the people trying to think of awkward questions to ask those folk from Church House who present national policy to being one of those people from Church House who is hoping and praying that the questions later won't be too awkward. And in making that transition, I become aware that those two things I just mentioned, that we principals of theological institutions took to be self-evident, can sometimes be viewed with a bit of suspicion. You really do need to do some theology if you are going to engage in change in the life of the church. Can be heard as, we're trying to block change we don't like, by asking for a process that will take years and generate a report that will be noisily rubbished or quietly ignored so that nothing will actually change. We know quite a bit about theology and about our area of work and the workplace to relate one to the other. Can we learn that? We know we're not in control. We don't much like it. And we want it back. Better or worse, I now see it from both sides. In a situation where change is proposed, the dynamics of power are being put to a greater or lesser extent into play. And there are opportunities to gain control and to lose control. There will be some who perceive their interest to be served by speeding things up, and some who perceive their interest to be served by slowing things down. Hopes and fears about that are inevitably stirred when serious change is being considered. And there's no point pretending to ourselves that because this is church and because we are theologians, it really isn't happening. But at the same time, neither is that ever all that is going on. And rarely is it ever even the main thing that
that's going on, which is why a cynicism that thinks itself wise in such matters misses the point over and over again. It is in fact true that those involved in change in the life of the church should be doing some careful theological thinking. And it is also in fact true that such thinking will be richest and most fruitful if it engages those directly affected by those changes in an intentional way. So, where is the theology? Is a perfectly proper question to ask in such contexts. But those who know some theology also know that the concept of theology is not one-dimensional. At the simplest, theology means something like the understanding of God. And therefore the question, where is the theology? At its simplest means, where is the understanding of God in this text, in this report, in this plan of action? And that is always a proper and important question to ask, and one that we need to keep asking in the life of the church, first and foremost of ourselves, of what we do, and what we say, and what we write. So we might ask, where is the theology? Because to put it bluntly, we're concerned that God seems to be missing. As to imagine, the University of Leeds has written of the dangers of practical atheism in contemporary churches. In a society where the idea of divine agency is considered simply irrelevant to getting things done in the real world, it's terribly easy, even for very devout Christians, to start acting as though God has no direct relevance to great swathes of our lives. At the same time, when we turn to the PCC accounts, we don't necessarily expect to see many references to the work of the Almighty. That's not, I hope, because we think God is irrelevant to our financial business, but because we think that what God asks of us in such matters is to use our intelligence to present the situation as precisely as possible, so that we can then seek the wisdom of God regarding what we should do in this situation. More often like this, those who ask where is the theology mean something a little different from that. The theology that we fear is missing is something more like a thoroughly worked out analysis of the situation under consideration, a proposal about how to respond to it, all drawing on the primary disciplines of academic theology in an appropriate and up-to-date and well-informed way. We want to know in crude terms that those initiating change in the life of the church have completed their theological homework. Sometimes we worry that they haven't actually done it at all, that they're just busting it, and there is no real justification for what we're meant to be doing. Sometimes we may by contrast worry that they have done their homework, but for some reason are not willing to share it with the likes of us. Perhaps because the theological thinking is of a kind we are likely to question or reject. Some or all of those concerns may, I suspect, be lurking around the slightly different question I was posed by Bishop Philip to answer tonight. Renewal and reform, does it have a theology? Some people are concerned might be that God has been edged out of the picture somehow, that the renewal and reform programme will subdue the Church of England under the Babylonian captivity of secular managerialism and allied sciences. For others, the fear might be that there is a detailed theological justification for all this, which is known to those on the inside, but no one will say anything, just what it consists of. I don't know, you may even come here this evening with the accompanying hope that I might just tell you what it is. But I imagine that the most the anxiety is likely to be that we appear to being asked to embrace some potentially far-reaching changes with associated long-term consequences that are inherently unpredictable. And no one has sat down and thought this through theologically. The homework hasn't been done. And, as I said earlier, change in the life of the church should be accompanied by some theological thinking. And the more serious the change, the more serious that thinking should be. Part of the issue here, I think, is the relationship between action and reflection. Action and reflection need to go together, but that doesn't mean it's a good idea to try to concentrate always equally on both of them at the same time. Sometimes it may feel as though we have to act and then reflect afterwards, but other times that we should reflect heavily before we act. But in reality, it's a cycle, a spiral, whatever image you care to choose to express the truth that reflection informs action, and action generates reflection. There are times when that cycle works well for us, and times when it doesn't function properly. And we act wrongly, either because we didn't reflect properly before we acted, or because we got so mired in our reflection that we failed to take action when we really needed to. And that's human life. I guess my point is that the idea of theology as a piece of extended academic homework that always needs to be completed first and then to go on and initiate things in the life of the church, I think that idea is open to question. Not least because we shouldn't stop attending to theology as soon as we actually start acting. The imperative is that action in the church is informed by and generates reflection. And in the context of the church, the native language for thinking and reflection is Christian theology. So with those preliminaries out of the way, it's probably about time that I answered the question. Does the Renewal and Reform Programme of the Archbishop's Council have a theology? I want to say yes. In three senses. So, 3 points, a good old-fashioned sermon. First, as a programme of action, Renewal and Reform has some substantial theological foundations regarding the understanding of the situation to which it aims to respond. Second, it makes a very significant theological judgment about the kind of response to that situation that is called for here and now. Third, if it is to take root and be fruitful, there will be an ongoing cycle of action and theological reflection. I'm just going to say a few words about each of those, particularly the first two. So there are theological foundations for renewal of the law. There's very important theological judgments being made under the core of that program. And there is also, I think, a kind of invitation to theological reflection. Let me start with those foundations. I'm aware that I work at Church House, I work for the Archbishop's Council, this program, this is, and this is sort of the daily world for me, where I even breathe and all that, and for some of you it may not be. So for many, there's a very good page on the church website about it. There's a Facebook group, and there's very easy ways to get some basic information. Renewal and Reform originated as a response by the archbishops in January 2015 to the reception in the Church of England of a report from the Church Growth Research Programme published in 2014, called From Anecdote to Evidence. That's where it begins. The archbishops reflecting on what happened in the reception of that report and saying, this is what we needed to do. From Anecdote to Evidence attempted to provide a careful evaluation based on an academically credible analysis of empirical evidence of factors that contribute to numerical church growth. The quotation on the front cover of the report from 1 Corinthians 3 verse 6 was intended to flag up the theological context for the work it summarized. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. The opening section of the report on the concept of church growth sketched out that context, affirming that God alone gives growth to God's church. And it set growth in numbers alongside growth in depth and growth in the outworking of discipleship as three vital and interrelated dimensions of church growth. We also linked growth to mission, and mission and growth appear consistently as a focal pair of terms in the initial set of reports in 2015 from various task groups within the Renewal and Reform programme. Now, some of you may remember from the Anecdote to Evidence was not without some attendant controversy of its own, but it did not come out of nowhere. The Church of England had participated fully in the increasing attention across many denominations and around the world that was given to mission during the final decades of the 20th century, and that continued into the 21st. Key landmarks in terms of Church of England's own processes would include the reports of Growing Partnership, Church of England and World Mission, the Presidency in some respects of all theological foundations, the Presidency and Prophecy in the interreligious and multi-faith context, and of course the Mission Shaped Church, Church planting and fresh expressions of Church in a changing context. And together, those reports comprise a very substantial theological resource on mission, church and growth, themselves drawing on a wide range of material from the Anglican Communion, including resolutions of the Lambeth of Conference, from ecumenical bodies, from many, many individual authors, and from mission agencies. There has been, over the past 30 years in particular, an incredibly intensive effort to think through these matters. Well, we might also note that alongside that has gone the rediscovery of some early texts. That's most notably for us the 1945 report towards the conversion of England. Renewal and Reform rests on the foundations of that extensive missiological work. I might think those foundations are open to criticism in various respects, or need to be adjusted in the light of ongoing research, but they correspond to a major development in academic and ecclesial theology that has been truly global and ecumenical. There's very thoroughly worked through in terms of the Church of England. So these are substantial theological foundations. They clearly anticipate, for instance, a particular focus in Renewal and Reform on empowering lay leadership and lay ministry, as well as its overarching concern to let the priorities of sharing in God's mission shape the life of the Church at every level, including its allocation of resources, and its formation of disciples and of clergy, the bishops among them. None of that is in and of itself particularly new, although the specific ways in which change is sought, maybe. The documents that underpin from Anecdote to Evidence is also helped to explain why the idea of growth, including numerical growth, should feature so prominently in Renewal and Reform's articulation of what the priorities of sharing in God's mission might be for the Church of England right now. This is a significant point because many churches today that share wholeheartedly in the desire to gear the life of the Church to and for God's mission are inclined to accept that the momentum of secularisation and the associated institutional decline of the Church are going to continue for the foreseeable future. And therefore that the primary missionary task of the church, or certainly an important part of the missionary task of the church here and now, is to adapt to that situation, rather than as a seek for numerical growth, as part of the growth that God wills for the church. So because the same part of my role in relations with other churches, and you know, I do pick up from talking to other churches that other churches look at us with a little bit of puzzlement sometimes. And a slight sense that, you know, this is the thing that you are trying to tell the ladies to stop coming. So some of the limitations you can see, it's because they just see things differently in terms of the relationship between mission and growth. Mission-shaped church is an important landmark in setting out the rationale for why the Church of England should see things differently in this context. And it has a very strong thing to say about being the established church. It says, as the established church, the Church of England has a special responsibility to seek to be a church for the nation. We are to serve those who reside in the geographical area, each parish, care for those who live in neighbourhoods that may overlap the parish geography, and minister to those who inhabit networks that are disconnected from the notion of parish and territory. Each is equally our responsibility and our care. The Church of England exists to be a church for the nation. This is not a comment on the issue of the church being established, but a statement of its mission purpose. A different report put it a year later, its comprehensive presence and duty of engagement with all, via a shared charge for the cure of souls, has continued to be a foundational distinction of the Church of England and an underpinning of its relationship with the state. But the Church of England patently cannot sustain that presence and engagement if its worshipping communities decline past a certain. To accept the inexorable momentum of decline is in effect to give up on the mission to which God has called us, or at least to accept that even if we can still fulfill it, if we die with ours or with the next generation. Therefore, the argument goes, faithfulness to mission in our case, the case of the Church of England, calls for us to be seriously focused on growth. Not only, but including numerical growth. Not so that we can be bigger, not because that would be what success looks like, but so that we can together be faithful to our particular missional vocation as we have received it and as we see it at this time. Out of confidence that growth is, as it were, a natural one, though not automatic, constant or guaranteed outcome of the Church being faithful over the long haul in its missional location. So it's a very careful presentation, I think, of many of the issues that are involved here. Is a section on theological foundations that was written for a report from the Diocese of Sheffield called Growing the Body of Christ, and published, I think, back in 2010, 2011. So that's the first part of my answer. Yes, renewal and reform has a theology in that it has theological foundations in the intensive work done within and well beyond the Church of England on the theology of mission and growth since the 1990s in particular. There's a program of action. While it needs theological foundations, renewal and reform also makes a very significant theological judgment about what the Church of England needs to do here and now in response to the description of the situation of the Church that comes out of all those resources. And the judgment is that what the Church needs is to be renewed and reformed. The importance of the choice of those words to be the title of the programme should not, I think, be underestimated. And one small indication of that is the switch in their order, if you were looking closely, you might not have noticed that the order of those two terms was switched back in the summer. I'll comment on that briefly in a moment. But let me begin by saying that these two words, renewal and reform, have a very long history in Christian theology, which their secular co-option in contemporary culture should not obscure for us. I was just talking to one of my colleagues as I was on my way out of the office, a colleague who's worked at Church House for quite a long time, and he said, oh yeah, Reform, and that sort of came up in the 19th century, didn't it, with the Reform back to the Blackburn. No, it didn't. It goes right back to the origins of Christian theology. It goes right back to the New Testament itself, via, forgive me for getting into technical, but it goes back to early Christianity through an early Latin translations of the Greek New Testament. Because in some of those early Latin translations, the verb reformare, the Latin verb in which we get our term, was sometimes used for Greek words, which are rendered in your English translations almost invariably by transform. So it's a way when you read transform, early Christians who read Latin were often reading reform. That would be the case in Romans 12, verse 2, to 2 Corinthians 3, 15, and Philippians 3, 21. One really important text, actually, in terms of the New Testament theology. And as with references to renewal in the New Testament, Ephesians 4, 23, Colossians 3, verse 10, Titus 3, 5, 2 Corinthians 4, 16, those Greek terms could mean both reversal to an original state, a kind of reset, and change towards something new. Yeah, it kind of takes two ways. Reversal of what's happened to take things back to how they were, and change towards something new and different. And it's been argued that holding those two senses together in creative tension, in particular with regard to the word reform in Latin theology of the early centuries, this was a highly significant development in Christianity that was without direct parallel in the ancient world. But if you like, think those two things at the same time. What takes us back to the beginning is what takes us forward to an end that's completely new and unprecedented. You can only imagine. And it seems to me that the underlying reason for that is in their New Testament context. Because in the New Testament context, these terms are, if you like, resurrection terms. Resurrection is a restoration of life from death. It's a reversal of what death has done. But resurrection is also new life, that is unimaginably different from the old life, and is separated from it by the abyss of death's nothingness. Resurrection restores creation according to God's original purpose. And resurrection at the same time transfigures creation in a way that is truly and utterly radical from the roots. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard. We have not arrived at the resurrection from the dead, and yet we know something here and now of the life of the world to come, which will also be the fulfillment of God's design from the very beginning. And renewal and reform, as they appear in the New Testament and in Christian tradition, describe how God works in the lives of the people in that interval between the resurrection from the dead of our Lord Jesus Christ and the sending of the Holy Spirit on the one hand, and on the other, our long-term resurrection from death in union with him at the end of the age. Renewal and reform are things that happen in that in-between time in which we now live. Renewal and reform are how we experience the power of the Holy Spirit to raise Jesus from the dead here and now in our time here on this earth, restoring in us the image of God in which we were created, and providing a pledge, a foretaste, and also a preparation, a getting ready for the life of the world to come. So how do we get from all that rich theological and spiritual tradition to
changing the formula for the allocation of church commissioners' funds to dioceses, or setting up a leadership training programme for cathedral deans. You know, if you get into the sort of nuts and bolts of Renewal and Reform, if you go to that web page and you start looking at some of the documents, you know, it's quite sort of technical stuff sometimes, I can see. Well, to understand that, I'm afraid I need to take you through a little bit of the history of the idea of reform over two millennia. I will try to make this as clear as I can. In the early centuries of the church, reform, like renewal, is primarily about the work of God in the life of the believer, conforming the one who is in Christ to the likeness of Christ. In late antiquity and the early Middle Ages, it begins to be applied also to monastic communities, to believers seeking to be reformed together in their common life. But the really pivotal development occurs in Western Middle Ages in the 11th and 12th centuries, when Western Catholicism begins to speak about the reform of the church, not just the person within the church. And Western Catholicism therefore begins to include institutional change as one aspect of that reform of the church. Because of that strand, it means it speaks of restoration, going back to origins, calls for the reform of the church, have tended in Christian history to include an appeal to former times, the Acts of the Apostles, the church of the early centuries. Once it is accepted that reform is both personal and institutional, then it also becomes evident that while God remains the primary agent of reform, human agency is also involved. Indeed, because proposals for reform have often been deeply controversial and encountered serious resistance from the 11th century on to the 16th century and beyond, it comes to be understood that when Christ desires to reform his church, he seeks active and focused support from his followers here on earth. So there emerges a certain duality in the idea of reform. God's work, but also our work. God transforming men and women into the likeness of Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, but also men and women themselves initiating, with divine prompting and guidance, changes to structures, customs, and practices. Through the later Middle Ages, those two sides continue to be held together more or less. The point of human reforming activity in the church is to respond to and to foster the reforming activity of God in the minds and hearts of the faithful. And what ultimately happens in modernity is that those two sides drift apart, and reform, as generally used today, and indeed in the Reform Act of the 19th century, has become completely cut away from its theological roots to mean only people initiating change to structures, customs, and practices. So one very important reason, I would suggest, for pairing renewal and reform in the contemporary context of the Church of England is precisely to keep alive their theological meaning. Because although renewal has been co-opted for secular purposes, it's remained much more of an ecclesial word, much more of a kind of church word, and moreover, a hugely important one over the past 100 years in Western Christianity. It's been a constant theme. We've had liturgical renewal, spiritual renewal, charismatic renewal, and many other ways of change and an energy that people have called renewal. And it's not only in the context of charismatic renewal either, that renewal has been associated in a particular way with the work of the Holy Spirit. In documents of the Second Vatican Council of the Roman Catholic Church, the third person of the Trinity is repeatedly identified as the one who renews
the church. Moreover, the agent of renewal in the life of faith is God alone. Yes, God's action with the risen humanity of the one Lord Jesus Christ always seeks a response on our part, but it is a response, it is a receiving of what God has done and is doing. And that's different from reform, where there is a human agency, something that's correlated with the divine agency. Moreover, to our ears today, the new man speaks more clearly of the newness that the gospel has, the tension between taking things back to how they were and taking things forward to a new and unprecedented place, which is there in reform, in Christian tradition. I think reform doesn't hold that sentence for us anymore, so we kind of need to put renewal with it to make it clear that we're also being taken forward into the new thing that God is doing, into what we can never have imagined. So the adjustment in order of the two terms that took place in the summer, there's been a question of General Silly about that, and a good response that I think is in line with what I'm saying for the Bishop of Sheffield at Semley in the summer. That adjustment seems to me to reflect an acknowledgement of the need to affirm the priority of grace in this context. The risen Christ making all things new, and that newness being made known and experienced in the life of the church. But such renewal also calls for reform, for setting right what has gone wrong, for a willingness to face conflict in the church for the sake of faithfulness to God's call, and for patient attention to the details of what I refer to as structures, customs and practices. Because those are the things that shape, for better or worse, our participation in the life of the church, and in many ways shape it decisively. And they therefore also shape and constrain our ability to respond to what the Lord may be saying to us. So yes, reviewing how money from the church commissions is allocated to diocese can be, not need be, but can be, a part of the work of reform for the sake of the church in renewal. So can ensuring cathedral deans have the necessary expertise to manage the complex business operations over which, for the time being, they presided. To include all of this under the banner of renewal and reform makes perfect theological sense, so long as there is a clear understanding that these various activities, in all their diversity and specificity, are intended together to help the church to say yes more fully and more wholeheartedly to what the Spirit is asking of us. And what is the Spirit asking of us? Well, here we go back to my previous point. The Spirit is calling us to commit ourselves to God's mission and to seek the growth of God's church. That's part of what it means to call this a program of renewal and reform. That this is where we find the locus of the renewing and reforming work of God at this time and in this place. That is the theological judgment at stake here. To label a set of initiatives about mission and growth, renewal and reform, is to say that the missional task requires nothing less than the renewal and reform of the Church of England by the grace of God, with the willingness of men and women in our church to put their shoulders to the wheel, to seek changes to structures, customs and practices in ways that may sometimes feel tedious and hard and even misdirected, and indeed may sometimes be misdirected, but will always be aiming at a fuller, deeper transformation of the church by the risen Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. And if mission and growth require renewal and reform and an openness to where they may lead us, then it is also true that the renewal and reform of the church in our time and place can only come about through dedicating ourselves to the task of mission, as is seeking the church's growth, as the fruit of God's indwelling amongst us. I think that is also part of the theological judgment that is at stake here. If we want to be renewed and reformed for our own sake, as something we can hold for ourselves within the boundaries of closed communities, you know, we're going to be disappointed and ultimately empty-handed. We can only have the treasure of the gospel in our churches if we are utterly determined to give it away. That is how the Spirit will renew us. And that is how Christ will reform us into his image and likeness. Renewal and reform. Does it have a theology? I've tried to argue that it has theological foundations in studies since the 1990s, in particular, on this theology. And that it offers a very particular theological judgment about how we need to respond by invoking the rich categories of renewal and reform. My final point is that if it is to take root and improve, there will need to be an ongoing cycle of action and theological reflection. Foundations, judgment, reflection. And reflection needs to involve the people participating in it. In the end, I don't like to quibble with the bishop's question, but programs of action can't actually have a theology as such. Only the people who are part of them can do that. Yes, those who design them and plan them, but also those who respond to them and take them forward, or indeed obstruct them or ignore them. It's all those people who have a theology. And even sticking with those who plan them and those who respond positively to them, their theologies won't necessarily be the same. Indeed, the Church of England being the kind of plural, hospitable, and indeed conflictual place that it is, we can pretty much guarantee that their theologies won't be exactly the same, and therefore the serious theological engagement and reflection by those participating in the new and will lead once in a while to some pretty significant theological argument. And that's how it should be. We need that. I said way back at the start of this lecture that theological thinking about changes in the life of the Church will be richest and most fruitful if it engages those directly involved in those changes in an intentional way. That means that the question of the theology of renewal and reform really cannot be primarily about the mythical theological homework that does or does not exist in someone's drawer at church house. So I want to end this lecture by asking you about how you see what I've been talking about this evening. Do you agree that the priorities of mission need to shape the Church at every level, and that for us in the Church of England at this time, those priorities should include striving so far as we can for Church growth, including numeric growth, and seeking to sustain the particular kind of ministry we have in this nation, and the particular opportunities to share the gospel that go with it? And if your answer to those questions is in the affirmative, even if it is with some significant conversations and some yes, but Jeremy kind of things, then does that yes, does it actually require nothing less than a renewal of our Church by the Holy Spirit so that we, as something that we need in order to respond to that missionary challenge, that we need that renewal, and are confident that we will find it if we really offer ourselves for the task and for the challenge? And if you would maybe answer yes to that question, again, there's some caveats and yes, but and the rest of it. What kinds of changes to structures, customs, and practices at every level of the Church might the Spirit be prompting us to make? And do we have the resources? Do we have the patience for the difficult tasks that will be needed to bring those changes about so that reform can clear the way for the energy of renewal and for the work of mission? That energy and that work is inseparable from one another and feeding each other. renewal and reform is to have a theology, then as well as substantial theological foundations and a significant theological judgment, it needs to be generating a reflective, critical, and creative theological conversation about these things. And I would hope that our time this evening can be a modest contribution to that.
Jeremy, thank you so much for inviting me to give this lecture. My expectations were high, but you shattered by that wonderful, beautifully rich meditation on a simple question. Thank you so much for what you've given to us. Many bits will stay with me. You can only have the treasure of the gospel in our churches if we are utterly determined to give it away. Thank you so much for helping us so much in our thinking about it. What I suggest we do now is just talk to our neighbours, so let's discuss. Talk about anything that struck you in that lecture, in particular anything you'd like to ask, or then have some time to ask Jeremy questions. Just turn to a neighbour. What struck you? Is there anything you'd like either just to Jeremy to clarify or anything you'd like to pick up? So, the first question I want to ask you, come on.
Jeremy, thank you very much for a fascinating lecture. I was listening very carefully and I heard the R and R words, but I missed the D word. And I was just listening for a reference to discipleship. So, and the fact it wasn't mentioned raised for me a question. Is that perhaps because you think there's something that the discipleship word has been required to do a bit too much theological heavy lifting in recent discussions about the future of the church? Or on the other hand, with your ecumenical hat on, do you think perhaps there's something we need to learn from our ecumenical partners who are reimagining themselves, in the case of the Roman Catholic Church, as a community of missionary disciples, or in the Methodist Church as a discipleship movement shaped for mission?
It's a fascinating question, obviously, because my instinct was from an early stage that discipleship, in some ways, is the pivotal category for how renewal and reform works out in the life of the church. And I guess one reason that I didn't say very much about it is I was trying not to repeat what I wrote in an article on the Renewal and Reform website, and I thought obviously you'd already read that article before. So I don't want to bore people to hear what I'm going to sleep. So I didn't focus on that, but in that article, one of the things I say is that there are various key points in the early Renewal and Reform documents, including the statement of the Archbishop's announcement, where they talk about the personal and institutional dimensions of renewal and reform. And going through the kind of new reform documents, which I did in that article, there aren't many direct references to what a personal reform renewal looks like and means. And it seems to me, if you sort of put the pieces of the jigsaw together, that the answer to the question of what a personal renewal and reform looks like in the life of the church in the renewal reform, but it is discipleship. And it's discipleship that sort of holds together the renewal of persons, that renewal into the likeness of Christ. The renewal of practices, which is a kind of sort of rather commonplace theological category since the 1990s, and complex reasons, but you're doing it. How do we change the way that we do things? And how that feeds into the resources and books up with that sort of high level change to structures that a lot of the task groups so far have been around. I do think that discipleship is absolutely critical to that. And I also reference Roman Catholic
work. I think that reference in Evangelical Gaudium, which isn't original, it's sort of apostolic exhortation by Pope Francis that came out in 2013 on the joy of the gospel. But he uses the phrase community of missionary disciples. The church is a community of missionary disciples. It's picked up in one of the Renewal and Reform documents, I think actually on discipleship. But I think that's a really good summary of what this programme is about. And if you look at the narrative and vision of Renewal and Reform that was taken to Synod this summer, actually kind of the first thing it says when it tries to explain is what the wisdom of Jesus is actually uses the discipleship word. So I think, I was kind of talking, if you like, about the theological motivations. In terms of what that looks like, particularly in what holds all this together, holds together that kind of institutional stuff with the lives of communities and men and women and parishes and dioceses up in the land, I think discipleship is actually pivotal. And I completely agree with you that we've got a great deal we can learn from and with other churches. In the debate on discipleship with Jameson, I remember Joe Woodrett, who's the representative of the Pentecostal actually making quite a powerful speech saying, we know a thing or two about this, and I'm not allowed to talk for some time. Thank you. It's a really good